Now, from our Missouri Historical Society Department of Programming, here's the Master of Programming, Aaron Pelker. He has a few important messages.
All right, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Missouri History Museum. As Ron said, my name is Aaron Pelker, and I'm a Community Engagement Coordinator with the Museum's Public History Division. And I do want to thank you for spending part of your Tuesday with us here at the museum. Before we get to our lecture, I have a couple of brief remarks. First, I'd like to thank our museum members and the Zoo Museum Tax District. Without their support, we wouldn't be able to host programs like this morning's. If you're interested in learning more about becoming a museum member, please visit our website. That is mohistory.org/support, or you can pick up a membership rack card at the kiosk just outside the auditorium. Also, I'd like to mention that only two of our three institutions are currently open to the public. That's here at the Missouri History Museum and the Soldiers Memorial Military Museum downtown, with our library and research center being closed to the public for renovations until January. So thank you for finding yourself here. Next, I do want to mention that our next daytime program at the museum will be back here in the auditorium next Tuesday on September the 20th at 11 a.m. with Chris Nafziger for a program titled Brewing Architecture, Limp Brewery. So we hope to see you back here in the auditorium for that one. And lastly, before we begin today's lecture, I do want to encourage you to visit the museum's restaurant, Cafe St. Louis by Pure, which is open now until 2 p.m. on the top level of the museum. So if you're looking for lunch, you really don't have to look far. And as always, I want to remind you that you can watch a recording of our previous daytime programs at the museum if you visit the Missouri Historical Society's YouTube channel. So with that, I will reintroduce our featured speaker this morning, Ron Elz, as you probably know him. Johnny Rabbitt, along with a great cast of guest speakers with Remembering Midtown and Mill Creek. Thanks. Enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Aaron. Yeah, we got a cast of thousands here today and a nice crowd, too. Glad to see everybody here. And thanks for being here. And our thanks to Post-Dispatch columnist Joe Holloman for letting his readers know of our program. Remembering Midtown and Mill Creek, those two center-of-the-city neighborhoods that are actually smack dab against each other and in part are really interconnected. They were developed adjacent to a stream, the 18th century French settlers call La Petite Rivière, the Little River, in other words. The river, which in the 19th century was diverted into the sewer system, was created by springs near Vandeventer and the Market Street area, which the springs are still underground there. That area is still, as it was, prone to a little flooding now and then. The wooded valley in which this stream ran became a section of the common fields, and in line with the French custom, the commons were public lands that could be used by anyone for pasture or for woodlots or for whatever, and that river ran all the way to the Mississippi, and it provided the settlers with a lot of water and a lot of timber. But there was some privately held land there, and too early, St. Louis inhabitants, Joseph and Roger Theon, settled at the Little River and started a small grist mill for the making of flour, and they built a little dam there as well. They soon sold out to none other than Pierre LaClede, who created a much larger mill and a much higher dam near present-day 8th Street, south of what's now Clark Street, by the Enterprise Center. In 1766, LaClede was also granted 1,000 acres along the Little River. Following his death, he was 49 when he died in 1778, the land was purchased by his stepson, Auguste Choteau. The mill area he bought ran west from what is now 4th Street. It's about 8 acres wide, 7,700 feet long. Well, the new dam was built by Shoto. It created a beautiful mile-long spring-fed lake, which we see here, which was used for boating, for swimming, fishing, picnics, and even for drinking water. Our image from 1848 has us looking south to the lake from what would become 8th and Gratiot. Property was called a great farm on the prairie, and the lake became known as Shoto's Pond. Well, the old adage, all things must come to an end, which dates to the 13th century, very prophetic for Shoto's Pond. This is the once golden pond as it looked in 1854, as it reached the end of the line after more mills and many more industries were built there, such as Collier's White Lead Factory that we see in this picture. All of these places lined the shores and caused irreparable pollution damage in those days before we had the EPA. Plus, the 1849 cholera epidemic and other diseases of which Choteau's polluted pond was sometimes rightly blamed, and not always, had to be drained by the city of St. Louis. At the time, the railroads were opening the Western Territories, and they really filled in that valley of Mill Creek with railroad tracks initially for the Pacific Railroad. This 1861 map is an important place in St. Louis Civil War history. It's Camp Jackson, which was on part of Peter Lindell's Grove between Grand and Ewing, Olive and LaClede, Midtown, Mill Creek. The story of the Camp Jackson massacre in 1861 is an interesting story to read. Here's an artist's description of Camp Jackson. The depiction was at that time, and that changed very quickly. A century later, after all that was built up in this area, and there was a lot in the area south of Olive Street, it was all done away with. For example, with LaClede Town, which had been created in part of this district, and that too is long gone, LaClede Park as well. Today, St. Louis University's Frost Campus, the campus on the east side of Grand, the Chaffetz Arena, and Harris Stowe State University cover a whole lot of this land. Long before the Comet was at Forest Park Highlands, wow, look at that thrill ride, cost a nickel to get on this. It was a roller coaster out of this, well, it was different. But for that time, it was probably a big deal. It was in Midtown at the southwest corner of 20th and Locust. A little creek also ran near there. Don't look for it, it is gone. This image is part of our first high-class, oh, I might have skipped one there, there it is, of our first high-class suburban, as they called it, residential street, Lucas Place. That's now part of Locust Street. Lucas Place ran from 13th to 18th Streets and had been part of farmland owned by Ann Lucas Hunt and her brother James Lucas. They developed Lucas Place as a retreat for the well-to-do to live. This is an 1860 wood engraving on part of that street with the Julia Choteau Maffitt residence on the left. That was at 1727 Lucas Place. There on the right of 17th Street is the original Second Presbyterian Church. Well, it was almost over for that old mansion that we just saw, but before it was razed, it was the site of this 1896 rally for having the country keep the dollar and the gold standard. This was in conjunction with the Republican Presidential Convention, which was held in St. Louis, at which William McKinley was elected the nominee. McKinley served as president from 1897 until he was assassinated, which was 121 years ago tomorrow. A little bit west in Midtown, we have a typical middle-class house of the time, of which there were many in Midtown and Mill Creek. This building at the southwest corner of Lucas and Compton had a doctor's office on the first floor, and he lived upstairs. From 1875, this was the Congregation Cher Emmeth. This was at 17th and Pine. 20 years after that, they'd stay in Midtown, farther west. They would be at the southeast corner of Vandeventer and Lindell. Jumping over Mill Creek Valley, it's this very strange 1863 mansion belonged to Jonathan Pierce. It was called the Cracker Castle, so named as Pierce made his fortune selling hardtack crackers to the Union Army in the Civil War. This very odd house was at the southwest corner of St. Ange and Choteau, heavily damaged in the tornado of 1896, and it was demolished in 1902. Back on Locust, Back on Locust, which was the street that the well-to-do once escaped to. Now we're looking west on Locust from 20th Street. This was in the 1890s, and obviously the glory days of refined living was over, except for the Campbell House Mansion on 15th and Locust, that today really is the best place to take a trip back to how our city's mansions really looked in the 19th century. Now this is the still confusing intersection of Olive, Lindell, Locust, Channing, and Teresa. The Plaza Hotel, later called the Drake Plazas, on the right, it and some other places in this picture, they're still around. The Drake is now there as an apartment building. Now, we were to head east on this section of Locust, right down the middle of this 1915 picture, we'd be on Automobile Row, now historic Automobile Row. And if you were there at 3037 Locust, the colorful small building that is still there, was the St. Louis dealership site of the Stutz Motor Car Company, maker of the classic Stutz Bearcat. Stutz started in 1911, but the Depression did him in 1935. Today, at that 3037 address, you're going to find the Fountain on Locust, and maybe you'll get the famous Johnny Rabbit Money Mulch while you're there. It's good for you. Now, how did a destination ice cream shop and restaurant find success in this out-of-the-way and once-run-down area of Midtown? It's like a soap opera. We're about to find out, but first, let's look at a couple of images of when that was Automobile Row. This one is Midtown's on Locust Street, first from 1933. It's the Wilgen Vincel Oldsmobile dealership. This was at 2927 Locust. And here, a couple of very eager car salesmen are there on the street. They're promoting the so-called now perfected freewheeling 1932 models. This was at Mound City Motors, 1821 Locust. I see that prices for it was either for a Plymouth or a DeSoto started you at $595. You'll find these winged wheel terracotta ornaments on top of the Cole Automobile Building in the 2700 block of Locust in the south side. Several years ago, Hilliker Corporation and the Horseless Carriage Club of Missouri installed markers in most of the one-time auto buildings in Locust, and many of them are still there. So you can see them in person, and you can also access them on the internet at HMDB. That HMDB stands for Historic Marker Database. Well, now with the story of the Fountain on Locust and its place in Midtown history, here's the Fountain founder, Joy Christensen, and you may well recall her as co-host of the very entertaining and popular Ron and Joy show in the morning on KC Radio. So she's on her way to the podium right now. Please welcome Joy Christensen.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Johnny. I always want to say thank you to Johnny because I really appreciate so much these things that he puts on, the historical things that he puts on. And even though I'm grateful that you asked me to be a part of it, even though I'm always terrified to be up here. And I don't want to say thank you so much because everybody's saying that in St. Louis now instead of thank you very much. And we say it like, you know, open the door for me. Oh, thank you so much. Like, it's the most awesome thing that ever happened. But thank you all for coming out here today. It's a very nice turnout. I am going to talk about what I know about Midtown and about Historic Automotive Row, because when I arrived on the scene, it was 18 years ago when we purchased the building that was a Stutz building. It was Supreme Motor Car Company building. And we now have three buildings on Locust Street. And Locust Street, when I first got there with the Historic Automotive Row aspect of the whole thing, I didn't know. I never heard of a Stutz car before. There were so many cars that Ben Hilliker was so nice with the Horseless Carriage Club to put on the plaques where you can walk down and look at them. And it's a fun afternoon to do that. But some of the names are so different. The Velli car, a Cole Standard, Holmes, Cunningham, Maxwell, Moon, Locomobile, the Stutz, of course, and the Nash were some of the names that I had never heard of before. But doing the research on the buildings, the Historic Automotive Row used to be houses, as Johnny said. In fact, when we excavated our building, we found the remains of a house beneath us. And they were still finding Indian arrowheads all up along Locust and Washington that predated that. It was in 1850 that houses started being built in that area. By 1867, Grand, which is just four blocks up, had the Grand Avenue Railway constructed the whole corridor through there, and they electrified it in 1890s. And I don't know if you watch the Victorian show that went for 6 years, you know what I'm talking about? Oh no. Downton Abbey, yes. How they're always looking at the chandeliers and the gas lights and the electric, because electric took 50 years before people actually switched over. They still hung on to their gas. So this was a big deal back in 1890s to electrify the whole street. And then it became very popular in Midtown. A Midtown almost rivaled downtown, in fact, for all the theaters and the shops and the retail restaurants and things that were happening there. But Automotive Row started occurring around 1911, and they took these houses, either demolished them or redid them to become for the automotive industry. It was for that reason. And at the time, it was many St. Louisans, for the first time in their lives, were going to buy a car. They would come to Historic Automotive Row. And it was something to see because they had all the plate glass windows. In fact, the Historical Society demands that we keep the plate glass windows now because back then, you didn't see that. You saw like the factory windows, which were large expanses of glass, but they had little panes. So to see a big expanse of glass like that and just building after building, it was really quite the show. And the formats of the buildings were almost all the same. Everything was automotive, either automotive manufacturing, automotive related, like batteries or, you know, something to do car tops, the canvas tops. But you would see a showroom front, then they would have like a median, which would be their offices, and then there would be garage space in the back. So it was very deceiving when you go in, you think this is the building, but there's huge space in the back where they would be either manufacturing the cars, like they would have two parked out in the front in the showroom, and you'd say, okay, I would like this, and then they go make you one in the back. It wasn't like you order one, although they did have catalogs, so they also looked and sold from catalogs. So back then, it was very, very interesting to come and go to Historic Automotive Row. The people that spent time on the street also had, I forgot to tell you, Eugene Field grew up on on Locust Street. He was born there. He lived there for the first 16 years of his life, and that was before the automotive industry came in. But there were 38 auto dealers at that time by 1918. And then by the way, how much time do I have left? Am I close to my 8 minutes? Okay. Okay. So I should be asking that throughout this. Where did I leave off here? I'm sorry. I'm getting my notes all screwed up. Okay. So for instance, in our building, over time, it was Olive and Locust that were the automotive areas. But Locust remained in the automotive industry all the time, even though Olive kind of switched. And at one point, when the movie industry turned to talkies from silent films, Olive became Historic Movie Row because a lot of the sound stage, they used them for sound stages, the big garages in the back, and they did that in Locust too. And in fact, the building that we had for the Fountain and Locust had, we found a big movie reel from Warner Brothers because it was used as a hub after that for sending out the big movies to all the theaters in the tri-state area. So they would all, they would send the actual movie on the reel and they would come to the building and then they would send them out from there. But the sound stages were used for recording the voices to make the silent movies talkies, and that happened afterwards. But Locust remained a automotive, either automotive related or automotive building street. Even when we bought it in 2004, it was a one-way street. Nobody could operate a retail business on a one-way street anywhere in the United States except New York, so that had to be changed. So we all got together with the neighbors at the time, and we went to Cape Girardeau and lobbied for it to be changed to a two-way street. We did a lot to make the street a viable street. Today, it for business, because people then at that time, they had been in there for decades. The companies in those buildings, They were operating out of the back mostly. They had the front all boarded up. Everything was boarded up in the front. They were brown bagging it every day. It was a really bad idea to open a restaurant there. but over time, you know, people, now there's like 9 restaurants there, and there's retail, and we have a lot of ad agencies moved in. So the 38 former automotive showroom buildings are now 44 ad agencies and a design district that includes a lot of retail and a lot of good things down there. So we're really lucky that that's turned out that way. But I will say, at one point, our building was also a place for Coca-Cola to just keep all their stuff. Like, at one point, it was a tire building for the tires were stored there. And then Coca-Cola did the same kind of thing because they were warehouse buildings. And when we first opened the fountain, I had to go ask soda companies, you know, to come. And the Coca-Cola lady came and said, I'm not going to do business with you because I don't think you're going to make it. So that, you know, and to think that they were back in our building. Well, I see my 8 minutes is probably up. So I'm just going to have to say thank you so much. And get out and vote.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Joy. We appreciate it very much. Joy is going to be involved with us on a tour that I'll be doing for Tammy Goldman at the History Museum. That's going to be October 22nd from 9 to 3. It's the official St. Louis ghost tour, the great ghost tour. That doesn't mean that she's a ghost, but she will be involved in it. I'll let you know more about that. I don't know if you can still get in on it, but you can always get your name on a waiting list. Midtown and Mill Creek changed time and time again. The most tragic was the basic scraping away of nearly all of what was in Mill Creek Valley, turning it into what became known as Hiroshima Flats. For example, churches, other than for one, were victims of a Mill Creek urban upheaval of basically 1959. Now, that church is not this one. That church was the Berea Presbyterian at 3010 Olive. Building still there, but it's now a business of some sort. The upheaval of churches, nothing new in Midtown and Mill Creek over the years as people moved west and north and south out of the district. One such case was this place, Pilgrim Congregational, started in 1853 at Garrison and Morgan. Morgan is now Delmar. That congregation moved to Washington and Ewing in this building in 1875. This is a stereo opticon image, and the building was only there until 1907. Now, this landmark has changed. Hey, wait a second. This stuff gets away from me. Hold on now. This landmark has changed very little since this picture was taken 130 years ago. Actually, the building was already 2 years old at the time. It's St. Louis University's DeBerg Hall. That's on Grand and West Pine in the area where Midtown and Mill Creek connect. On the right, you can see a little bit of St. Francis Xavier College Church as it was being built. And here we are in 1920, looking west from Grand onto Lindell. The Melbourne Hotel would be erected the next year on the right in 1921, northwest corner. Still there now is Jesuit Hall. And that white building, a three-story mansion, was that of Peter L. Foy. That was at 3617 Lindell. And here's that Foy mansion again. This picture from the late 40s after it had been converted into an Elks Club Lodge. Site today is the parking lot for Jesuit Hall. At the northwest area of Midtown, there was Vandeventer Place, the private place that many Lucas Place families had moved as they attempted to escape the commercialization, noise, pollution, and crime of their old downtown neighborhood of Lucas Place. Vandeventer Place was bordered by Grand and Vandeventer, Bell and Enright. Our picture dates to 1902. The Mill Creek Valley neighborhood was not directly home to such fancy private places, though the very far south end of the valley was at Lafayette Square. This picture is of the Edward Mallinckrodt residence, 27 Vandeventer Places, from 1889. The kids are out there playing on the front lawn. Interesting to see that they were not looking at video games and iPads. Wait, let's go inside the Mallinckrodt mansion, into the drawing room. Of course, no radios or TVs sitting around at that time. It's unfortunate that photos of interiors really are very scarce, very hard to find. Now we'll have a really quick tour of the Grand and Olive Entertainment and Transportation Hub of Midtown. which at the time of these photos was when many of the buildings were filled with medical offices all around there before the doctors all fled to the west. From 1895, on the southeast corner of Grand and Olive, the building we see, the Grand Avenue Hotel was owned by L.H. Girardi, who also operated the grocery store on the first floor. Next, it's what had been the Grand Avenue Presbyterian Church, 527 North Grand. This image is from 1916, and you'll see that a small movie house called the Midway had been built in front of the former church. Theater is under all those billboards. It's just a little bitty place. Before that church was erected, the site was the eastern terminus of the narrow gauge railroad that ran all the way to Florissant, sort of like today's Metrolink. And this is the Fox Theater under construction. This picture is from December 3rd, 1928. That's the old Beers Hotel on the left. It would open just a short time later, January 31st, 1929. Unfortunately, for residents of Mill Creek, who were mostly African-American, it would be many years before they could see a show at the Fox or any other so-called white theater. Over the years in Midtown, in the Mill Creek area, there was a total of 31 theaters for African-Americans, most of them quite small. Today, those theaters and their buildings are gone, and right now, the future of the fabulous Fox, which was rescued from demolition 40 years ago by Leon and Mary Strauss. The Fox is under a cloud due to a pitched battle going on to this day regarding leases and ownership related to both the building and the land it's on. I hope it makes it. This is a look at Grand and Olive in 1921, and you see in the distance there's no Missouri and no St. Louis Theater. They'd be just a couple of years away. Big building that overlooks Midtown to this day and also over Mill Creek. This picture's from, 1930. It's the Continental Life Insurance Building. It was 286 feet tall, 23 floors. It was designed by a guy who was best known for his school designs, William Itner. Here we go for a dance. This is Toontown, the former Arcadia Ballroom, a block east of Grand at Teresa, 3515 Olive. We see a dance going on with Columbia Records band leader Frankie Carl and his orchestra. This was 1946. Later, the place became a bowling alley called Sports Bowl. It was torn down in 1966 to make way for a parking lot. That's what's still there today. At the time of this picture, the ballroom had a white-only policy. A ballroom that did cater to blacks in this area was the Castle Ballroom at the northeast corner of Ewing and Olive. It's not there anymore. And there was a ballroom atop the People's Finance Building in Jefferson and Market, an area that was known as the downtown of the African-American community. From the spring of 1944, it's the graduating class of the original Catholic Xavier High School, then at 3723 West Pine. It wasn't that much longer, September 21st, 1947, that the Archdiocese of St. Louis integrated the school system. Now, this is a look from 63 years ago. We see the early stages of the demolition of the Grand Avenue Viaduct Suspension Bridge, which was built in 1891. This was the principal bridge that moved traffic over the Mill Creek Valley. It ran from Gratiot to Market, and it was replaced as part of the urban renewal project that devastated the Mill Creek neighborhood and displaced nearly 20,000 people, mostly African Americans. The bridge has been replaced two times since the new one's built in 1959. When you visit the Mill Creek Valley south of Olive, you'll see very few buildings that existed before the 1950s. As the mid-century extreme urban modernists, along with misguided politicians, business leaders, and others, followed one time Mill Creek resident General William Tecumseh Sherman's plan that he used in the destruction of Atlanta. So Mill Creek was destroyed. Almost no input from the people who lived or worked there, or owned buildings, or had businesses there. And there was very little compensation given for those thousands of people who were basically evicted. The idea, which sounded good on paper, was to build a new city by simply eliminating the old. Plus, Highway 40 had to be built somewhere, so Mill Creek became the target. But north of Olive, there's a great number of buildings that did manage to survive and be revived there. Many places date back 100 years or more. It's something to see, to pause, take in, what you really maybe never have seen before. This picture from times past in Mill Creek has us at the intersection of 8th and Poplar in 1905, looking across the railroad yards to the Cupples Station warehouses on the left, and the Simmons Hardware Company warehouse. This is a look at some people who are looking. See the road construction at the bottom of this picture. They're looking at the reconstruction of the Grand and Olive area. This was in 1906. And here's the train shed under construction in 1894 at our new Union Station. There was considerable replacement of buildings when this massive station was created, but very few were residential. And now we have Will Smith of the Lawrence Group here, a Lawrence Group and now and found division of that organization, to tell us some of their restoration and development projects in Midtown and Mill Creek, proving that saving buildings can very often be much better than tearing them down. By the way, the Lawrence Group redid the Missouri Pacific Union Pacific building at 13th Street between Olive and Pine, in which KMOX Radio is located. So please welcome Will Smith.
Thank you, sir. Hello, good morning, everyone. And thank you, Johnny, and thank you all for having me this morning. You all may be familiar with Lawrence Group. It's a architecture and design firm in town. We've been associated with development for the last 20 years or so, but in the last two, rebranded and kind of spun out our development and hospitality investment firm titled New and Found. And part of the idea with that name is around how our philosophy towards development and investing. It's seeing something, finding value in what's already there, bringing newness to that. And so we talk a lot about unlocking the potential in spaces, often spaces that others have overlooked and undervalued. And so I'm going to share a little bit today about that. Focusing on this neighborhood, the Midtown neighborhood, where we have performed several projects over the last 20 years from a development standpoint. We also have some developments focused around downtown and South Grand, but I'll focus today on our Midtown development and go through each one here on the slide, on the screen. First, I'm going to start with the collection of properties at 3411 Olive. Historically, they were a part of the automotive area. Most recently, though, it had been used as a printing company, printing large-scale billboard scale prints, but then had gone, a large section of the building had gone vacant. Kind of continuing on the automotive row theme, my father, Steve Smith, has a motorcycle passion, of which I've developed a little bit myself. And so we turned this, we turned this into a little bit of a hobby gone wrong or right, depending on which way you want to look at it. In 2007, we redeveloped the building into the Moda Museum, an event space, followed by Triumph Grill, a motorcycle-themed restaurant that caters additionally for that event space. And then in 2010, Moda Europa, which is a KTM, Ducati, Triumph, and Vespa dealership. And so that we've kind of extended automotive row in that way at the Olive. And this actually is right next to the Drake apartments that Johnny mentioned earlier. Further up the street on Grand was the HQ for the carburetor company, and a parking lot for that building right behind it, which housed at the very top of it two floors for the Knights of Pythias secret society. Kind of interesting to have a secret society on top of a parking garage even then. But this building had been vacant for several years. And in 2011, we worked with the Confluence Academy organization to redevelop it as an arts-centered charter school. So that's about 115,000 square foot building dedicated to the arts in both middle school and high school. And that was an interesting project because we actually took the parking garage back and converted it into a classroom space. So there's no longer that parking garage there. It's been converted for use for people. Ooh. All right, back onto Olive, right next to the Mona Museum, was a facility that I understand had been constructed to support, you know, during the turn of the century, there were a lot of new hotels built for the World's Fair. A lot of those facilities needed laundry performed. And so this building, right at where Olive and Lindell meet, again, right next to the Drake Hotel, probably at that time, and currently the Drake Apartments, was a laundry facility to serve the hotel use, both downtown and in Midtown. It had been vacant for several years when we partnered with SLU on this one, and in 2011 we opened a 51-key boutique hotel called Hotel Ignacio at St. Louis University. Unfortunately, with COVID, this has taken a little bit of a pause, but SLU is working on kind of what it's going to look like next. The next property is in Grandel Square. It was developed in 1912 as a German language theater. Around that time, with World War I kind of right around the corner and the anti-German sentiment, it was rebranded away from German affiliation, but it had originally been built to serve the German population in St. Louis, which we know is significant. It's also previously been known as the Lynn Theater, and then at some point in time it became the Sun Theater. But it had been vacant since 1981, and as you can see, pretty poor condition when we purchased the building. And that is what it looks like today. So we again partnered with the Grand Center Arts Academy to provide them with a real state-of-the-art theater facility. And so this is a 650-seat theater that's now a part of the Grand Center Arts Academy's facilities. Back onto Grand, in the 1920s, the Missouri Pacific Theater, or the Missouri Theater Company building, which Johnny had showed a photo looking down Grand, that had not been built yet. And so this is a more contemporary or pre-development from our standpoint image. But this had been built along that theater row. Something I think is pretty fun is it was the home of, and I apologize about a spelling thing here, not the Music City Rockettes, but the Radio City Rockettes. And that's really the Rockettes. Now in New York, were actually founded here, and they started in this building. And so that had been vacant as well. This was the last vacant structure along Grand in Grand Center. And we partnered with Grand Center, Inc. to envision a new use for this building. And so now this is the On God Arts Hotel, which I hope everyone has a chance to go visit at some point. It's got a wonderful rooftop bar with 280-degree views of downtown North City and South City. And one of the things that I'm really proud about with this has been our overall development is focused on community. And so we do biannual and quarterly call for entries on artist submissions. And we see this as a gallery hotel. So everything that's in there is done by a local artist, I think 200-mile radius around St. Louis, and is for sale. So please check it out. Support our local arts community. We show below market commissions. It's not our main business model to have arts in there. It's really about trying to promote and get promote what the good art that's going on in our region. Down on Forest Park Avenue was the Century Electric foundry plant built in the 1920s. Over it had been several different users, but manufacturers since then, ending with Federal Mogul Corporation, which closed the plant in 2007. We talked to a lot of residents that had lived around there for a long time that noted the smell that it put out for almost a century. Our organization stumbled in here back in 2015 and saw saw kind of an incredible vision. And so what this is now today is City Foundry, which I hope you all maybe can go have lunch at after this event. But it's open now on Tuesdays. We've opened 7 days a week now, so that was a new, a relatively new change. So, but we're very proud of this. It's something that, again, where we've tried to see potential and opportunity. We have about 20,000 weekly visitors, and we're very proud of the local business community that is there. All the vendors in the food hall are local owners and operators, and we're just getting started here. So we have phase two under construction, additional housing and office space. And then last but not least, on Washington Boulevard, this was another motor car company and a dealership. It was a two-story dealership and had changed hands a few times, was later a radiator, but dedicated to the auto industry. And then since the 60s, it had been really used as printing storage facilities. And this is currently under development. We are converting this into a 1,200 capacity concert venue with Old Rock House that we hope to open next year. And so with that, thank you all, and hope you have a chance to check all these projects out.
Thank you, Will. That is very interesting. There, with the things that can be done, you can see when buildings are still around and not taken away. Fortunately, Union Station was not taken away, though there was some talk of that at one time. The African Americans who lived in Midtown and Mill Creek did not have to go far for medical care, as the district had two hospitals. This is the 75-bed People's Hospital, 2219 Locust, that opened in 1903 as Provident Hospital. It was the only private hospital in St. Louis that treated African Americans. It lasted until 1967. The building's still there. As far as I know, it's empty. And we have another hospital. This was at 2945 Lawton Boulevard, City Hospital number 2. This is how it appeared when it opened in 1919. Black doctors were trained at this hospital. It also had a school of nursing, and it became a very outdated facility not much after it opened in 1902. It was originally the Centenary Hospital and Barnes Medical College. Well, this is a look at a City Hospital number 2 operating room. In 1920, the hospital fell into disrepair. It was closed in 1937 after a newspaper expose, complete with photos, compared the medical facility with that of the St. Louis Zoo. Blacks were treated, though, at City Hospital number 1, but they were relegated to a special ward. The building that we've been looking at was converted into the Midtown Hotel, and its main claim to fame was that in the 1940s, it was home to the Glass Bar, that, according to musicologist Professor Bill Moriarty, who's with us today, was appropriately decorated with glass blocks. It was owned by Al Fine, or Al Feingold. Then, same owner in the 1950s, had a decor change, and it was renamed Peacock Alley. Under both identities, it was a place where many of the nation's top jazz musicians played. Over the years, there were dozens of hotels and rooming houses in which African Americans could stay, as listed in the famous travel guide for African Americans called the Green Book. These included several hotels in Midtown and Mill Creek, the Booker T. Washington and Jefferson, Grand Center, Jefferson and Pine, Corona number 1 on Olive, Corona number 2 on Clark, Dunbar and Market, and the YMCA on Pine and the YWCA on Locust. Well, that Midtown hotel that we saw closed in 57, the building soon a victim of the Mill Creek Urban Destruction Project. The land on which the Midtown Hotel stood would soon be near the east end of the federal government-backed LaClede Town project, though the word project was seldom used in referencing LaClede Town and LaClede Park. Well, the first time I met our next guest, Ron Fagerstrom, was 21 years ago when I interviewed him on my radio show in regard to his then new book, Mill Creek Valley, A Soul of St. Louis. In planning today's program, I looked through my library, came across his book, and saw that it fit perfectly with our program today. Now, since I had not spoken with Ron since 2001, I thought, I'm never going to be able to find him. So I tried the phone number I had for him in my Rolodex, of all things. There's an item from the past. But not only was he there, he still lived in the same place all these years later, and he agreed to tell us about some of the people he interviewed for his book and what they had to say about living in Mill Creek. The History Museum gift shop has copies of his book that he can sign after our program is over, and that's the same for our next guest speaker, Vivian Gibson. You'll meet her in a few minutes. So right now, please welcome Ron Fagerstein. Ron?
Thank you very much, Johnny. I apologize for sitting down, folks, but I have Parkinson's, and this is my best way of being mobile for you.
That's okay. Well, how many people from Mill Creek did you speak with when you wrote your book?
I interviewed 12 people. They either lived there or went to school there or worked there.
And well, about yourself, were you ever a resident of Mill Creek or Midtown?
No, I wasn't. I moved to St. Louis about 40 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Which, in what area do you live now?
Lafayette Square.
Well, you're very close, though.
Oh, yeah.
You're right next to it on the south end. In general, how did the people you spoke with reflect about Mill Creek? What are some of their general thoughts?
Well, they had a lot of different thoughts about it. Eyes of the beholder. Some said that homes were beautiful. Some say we came up in situations weren't fit to live in, but we had no place else to go, so we had to live there.
In blocks, if you can recall, about how many blocks was the general area size of Mill Creek?
100 blocks.
100 blocks, basically all torn away. Now, what type of, there weren't just residences there. People didn't just live there. They worked there. They had businesses there. What type of stores and businesses did you find there?
There were grocery stores and clothing stores primarily. One of my residents worked in a grocery store. Mm-hmm.
It was a real major neighborhood. I mean, it had pretty much everything you really wanted to have right there.
It was the downtown. It was the downtown of the black community.
Yep.
And I can only imagine what St. Louis would be like today if that had not been torn down.
Yeah.
If that had been.
You really wonder what it could have been. Had the Lawrence Group been around at that time, they could have done something about it. What about office buildings? Are there any large office buildings here?
Well, somebody mentioned earlier the People's Finance Building, mm-hmm. which was where the black doctors and lawyers and other professionals had their offices.
In your talks with people, did you talk to any of the school teachers or principals?
Yes, three of the residents I spoke with were also teachers, and they took much pride in their people. There was such a warm feeling of community in Mill Creek Valley. People took care of each other.
That's really nice. And where did the people who live there come from? They weren't all from St. Louis, were they?
No, a lot of them came from the south. This was a stopping off point. And as one guy said, they made a pallet in their house where the people could just stay. In other words, they just put down blankets and sheets and pillows on the floor for them to mm-hmm. sleep on until they found a place to live.
And people watched over each other, I would imagine, as a community.
Very much. One fellow remarked that people would have kids over for breakfast on their way to school, as an example, and they would send them off with a lunch for school.
And about the people who lived there, when you talked to them, did they think it was a good thing that it was all torn down? Did they see this as a positive thing, or were they unhappy?
I think they were pretty much unhappy.
Yeah.
They knew things could be better, but that was their home. That was, for example, one of my residents had a grocery store there. What is he going to do now? Can he just start a new grocery store somewhere else? He can't. He has the base of business with people that live in the area.
What about the condition? Our last question about the residential properties when it was being torn down. Were they all? They called it a slum. Was it a slum?
One of my residents said they called it a slum, but they were just saying that because they didn't live there. He said, our homes were beautiful.
That's great. Ron Fagerstrom, thank you. And he'll be at the gift shop with
yes.
your book. I'm glad to see the book is still in print. And we're glad to see you're still with us. And thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Incidentally, we were talking about projects. And everybody remembers Pruitt-Igoe. There is a big event coming up this Saturday. From 1 to 7, it's the second anniversary of the Pruitt-Igoe Forever Picnic Celebration. It's at DeSoto Park on 20th and Carr. And there have been revivals of groups of people who lived in the LaClede Town area, but I don't know of anything coming up now. One of the most interesting, enjoyable, and truly haunting books about St. Louis that I've read in quite a while was written by our next guest, Vivian Gibson. It's called The Last Children of Mill Creek. And in it, she beautifully and nostalgically tells about her life growing up as one of the last children of Mill Creek, as well as about the people who lived there, the businesses, the churches, the buildings, the institutions, the housing that were simply done away with in the name of urban renewal. Justifiably, Vivian has been named Author of the Year by the Missouri Library Association and a winner of the Missouri Humanities Literary Achievement Award. I did a program for Oasis yesterday, and they mentioned that some of her knowledge of writing came from Oasis classes. Now, what was living in Mill Creek like? Well, here's Vivian to tell us some of the story of her life in that now erased, except in memory, Mill Creek neighborhood. Please welcome Vivian Gibson.
Thank you, Ron. It's the little button on the right. Okay. Well, I'm going to confess that I sent the wrong group of slides. But this has to do with Mill Creek, but it's a totally different talk. So I'm just going to leave the title there because that's what's going on here. Deferred stories. You've heard a lot about buildings and theaters and automobile plants and showrooms, but my book is about people, about families, about community. Sometimes it sounds nostalgic, especially when you've heard so much about it being a slum. I wrote a book about 2.5 years ago, and we all remember what was going on 2.5 years ago. My book was scheduled to be published and released in April of 2020. In March of 2020, I was supposed to have a launch here in this building for my book, and it was canceled. So I had to figure out how to get this book out into the world. So I did a crash course in social media, started Zooming. I quickly learned that the grounds had been even in terms of big publishing companies and me in my condo kitchen, because everybody was having to figure out how to promote their books. And I have to say, I did a really good job. Because this book is in its second printing. It has been so popular, I cannot believe. Ron is right. After retiring, I see my old boss here. It makes me a little nervous to talk in front of him. After retiring from Big Brothers Big Sisters, he was my boss at another location, at St. Louis Public Schools. But I decided to take stories that I had been writing for years and years and years. Well, they weren't stories. Some of them were just paragraphs. Joined a writing workshop at Oasis and just fell in love with writing and workshopping and finding out that my stories were of interest to a lot of people when they were really just personal stories about me. I thought I was writing about my mother, and it turns out I was writing about a community. I like to, since I don't have the right slides, I will talk to you about the fact that my book was so well received. I got wonderful reviews as far as London and Los Angeles, but a lot of love from St. Louis, except from the Post-Dispatch. They never did review my book. There was a reviewer in the Missouri Life magazine who wrote something that really sticks with me, and I'm going to read you the opening to his review. And his name was Evan Wood. And Evan wrote, "Imagine yourself in a city or a neighborhood where you used to live. Maybe you're on a Sunday drive showing your kids the house you grew up in just across town. There's a sense of nostalgia for the part of yourselves that is no longer there. Now, imagine that the street you lived on was bulldozed, cleared away, subsumed by an interstate highway. Well, I don't have to imagine, because I remember. I remember living there, and I was, in fact, one of the last generations of children who lived in Mill Creek when it was destroyed in 1959. Now, when I started talking about Mill Creek, it was really before my book. When you leave here, you can go on the second floor, and there's a exhibit that's a composite of our three-room apartment in Mill Creek that's been there for 20 years. So I've been talking about Mill Creek for a long time, but I was always a little disturbed and kind of hurt to hear it, one, described as a slum, and two, when people would say they'd never even heard of it, as if we weren't there. Where was it? Grand? Near St. Louis University? Market Street? And there was so much. Johnny's covered a lot of what was there, but there was the Negro League baseball stadium that was at Compton and Jefferson. We talked about the People's Finance Building, which was the jewel of Mill Creek, because it was built by black people, and it started off as a mortgage, a financial firm, because black people couldn't even get mortgages from white banks. And when it was built in 1920, it was touted as built by black people for black people. And so there was a lot there, a lot of history. You hear that it was an older part of the city, and there were lots of white people and Europeans that were there before us. And once white people started moving out north, south, west, it was the oldest part of the town, and it was neglected. And it was then left for black people. And because of restricted covenants, we couldn't live anywhere else. And because of those covenants, there were prominent black people there, middle class people who lived in lovely homes on some of those mansions that you saw. Black people bought those and lived there. But then, of course, there were poorer people, many of them who had come from the rural South to live there. They were living in crowded conditions because they lived just like everybody else. When you come to a country, you go where the other people are. And so it became a very crowded, a very dense community with very poor infrastructure that was not upkept. And suddenly it became a valuable piece of land because it was right next to Union Station. It was downtown. People coming into Union Station, the city didn't want them to see a slum. But we had been restricted. So what do you do? Where do we go? There were 20,000 people there. And the bond issue there was a bond issue put forth that failed in 1947 for that reason. Where do they go? It was fine to keep us contained and not even know we were there, to drive down Market Street and not look to the right or the left to see that there were all black people there, the very people who cleaned houses, who worked in those foundries, that worked in the car dealerships, all of those laundries. Those were black people working in those laundries. Luckily, they were there and they could walk to them. It was a walking community. But suddenly, there had to be a place to put us if they were to use that land and reclaim it. By the way, after World War II and all the white men came back and sent white women back to their homes, they also put black people out of a lot of those jobs. They built those highways And those white men from World War II built those highways, bought some cars, bought some houses, went to the suburbs, and the city died. So there's a deferred story that we sometimes have not heard. And I'm happy to say that even though I was talking about people, about families, about support, about community, I really wanted to humanize what was going on in the city and to show exactly how we live in these two societies. And if we don't start talking about what happened and how it happened and the unfairness, we're never ever going to move forward. So one of the really important aspects of writing this book was that I would get a chance to tell our story. And because of COVID, a lot of the storytelling came from through Zoom. And I got to talk all over the country, but I also got to talk to children in schools, which was not something that I even considered. A social studies teacher from Clayton Middle School asked me if the school bought my books for her sixth grade social studies class, would I be kind enough to talk to them on Zoom? Well, absolutely. So I mentioned, we did it, it was wonderful. The kids had wonderful questions. I posted it on Facebook and opened floodgates. Teachers were so interested, and I just wasn't expecting. So I'm talking to sixth graders, I'm talking to high school students. Now, there's a course at Washington University in Urban Studies that studies my book. But the kids are doing wonderful projects. They're creating museum exhibits about Mill Creek. And then I had a chance to work with John Burroughs School. Well, John Burroughs did it really big, really big time. So they had a whole series of talks. I talked to the teachers and the parents, the alumni association, and the teachers combined a social studies class and an English class. Now, every year at John Burroughs, I understand that the English class studies A Raisin in the Sun. This year, they studied The Last Children of Mill Creek. So I was so pleased about that. So I'm not going to take much more of your time because a lot of the pictures, frankly, that I had in the slides that I should have sent, Johnny had them in his presentation, and I think you got a good sense of what Midtown and Mill Creek used to be. What I'd like to do for you today is to read for you part of the project from the John Burroughs sixth grade English class. So they read it. I met with the students. They had wonderful questions. And I thought, this is where the story should be shared with these children who are our future and who cannot say that they didn't know we were there. So this one of the projects that they had was for each student, after studying the book over an entire semester, the teacher asked the students to write a phrase or a word from the book that resonated with them or that just made them understand me and the story and Mill Creek. And then they took all of those ideas from the students and they put them in what they're calling a collaborative poem. And the poem is called Where I'm From, a collaborative poem in the voice of a young Vivian Gibson. So these are all phrases and words that the students chose, and they're all put together here. I am from Mill Creek Valley, St. Louis, America. I am from the backyard and grass and dirt between my toes. I am from grandmama, mama, Daddy. From Jean, Beverly, Tootie, Laverne, Randall, Honey, Furman, Pat. I'm from March and Janice. Aunt Mary and Miss Little Bit. Miss Marguerite and Miss Jenny. I am from the sky and brown shoes, from hats and small shops, from the cats and the junk man roaming in the alley. I'm from cornbread and pot liquor and fried chicken and marrow from the bones. I'm from ironing church clothes on Saturday nights and going to Northern Baptist on Sunday mornings. I'm from hard work, craftiness, wholehearted living. I'm from mama's whistle and church bells and grandmama and the phone calls to her white folks. I'm from bacon and buttermilk, American cheese and candy, King Hong's Cafe and the bruised fruit behind Soulard Market. I'm from daddy and grandmama's Saturday morning visits. I'm from making mud pies and chopping wood with an axe. I'm from bacon grease and my own home cooking. I'm from mama getting mugged and daddy getting hit. I'm from happiness and sadness and hopefulness. I'm from early morning chores and walking to school. I'm from life, love, community, home, and belonging. I am from kids, grown-ups, and dandelions. Thank you.
Thank you, Vivian. That was really, really wonderful. Ah, what about her book? She's going to be going up to the gift shop, and if you'd like to get a copy, I've forgotten the price, like $15 or $16.95, so it's not expensive as far as a book is concerned today, and it's well worthwhile to find out about that memorable time of growing up in Mill Creek Valley. And something to think about, here we are at the History Museum, and we're actually just between 15 and 20 blocks away from where Mill Creek was. Thanks to all our presenters today, and of course to you for being here. My October Missouri Historical Society program, I mentioned the great ghost tour Saturday, October 22nd. When I was in the back, I got a call from Busty Hart, who is one of our regular attendees, and she said she found out today it's been filled for 7 months. So, but she was told, put the name on standby, you never know. And incidentally, if you are a ghost or become one, we will make room for you. No charge. Then on Tuesday, November 15th, right here in the Lee Auditorium, we'll present The Front Row. It'll be a look back at our town's theaters, theatrical groups, those who gained national fame from Tennessee Williams to Vincent Price, and talk about movies and show clips of movies and TV shows made here or that relate to St. Louis. And we'll have even a short radio-style dramatic show like we used to on the radio back in the 30s and 40s. And if you get a chance, please tune in to my weekly entertainment column of the air. It's at 8:50 Sunday morning on KMOX. Now, we suggest that you see, while you're here, if you can, at the History Museum, look at the Coloring STL exhibit and look at the artifacts that are there from various buildings in St. Louis. Plus, take time. There's a 40-minute slide presentation that is beautifully done. Also, the St. Louis Sound exhibition is still there, and I even happen to be in it. And see the World's Fair exhibit now because it's going to be taken down and redone in the not-too-distant future. So that's our program for today, and we thank you all very much for being here. Thank you.